At some point, you learned about the geometry of three-dimensional space. And when you did that, you probably saw the dot product, and how useful the dot product was for doing things like projections, finding angles, getting laws about triangles, and so on. Well, we want to do the same thing for a general vector space. So an inner product is going to be something that we do on a general vector space that behaves kind of like the dot product behaved in R3. So we denote it by brackets. There are many different notations for inner products. We're going to use this bracket notation. So this is the inner product of the vector on the left side of the bar and the vector on the right side of the bar. The inner product of x and y. And you know, this is, if you think of this as being like x dot y, this is in any old vector space. But if you think of it as being like x dot y, you recognize that this is a property that you're used to seeing. Ax plus by dot z is ax dot z plus by dot z. So, this is a property we'd like to have carry over to any old vector inner product. We call that linearity. It's actually linearity in the first factor. And you'd also like to be able to expand things with regard to the second factor. We call that linearity with respect to the second factor. And if you take dot products, x dot y is the same thing as y dot x, so we'd like that to hold for a general inner product. We call that symmetry. And the last thing we'd like is we'd like the inner product of any vector with itself to be positive. Well, unless it's the zero vector. If it's a zero vector, you get zero. But for any non-zero vector, you get a positive number. We call that the positivity of the inner product. So let's see some examples of things that are inner products. The first one is if we're in Rn. Remember, a vector is in Rn is a column. So the inner product of one column with another column is the transpose of the first times the second. And I suppose I can put an arrow on these. And that just works out to x1, y1 plus x2, y2 plus xn, yn. This is just like the usual dot product, only with n terms instead of 3 terms. And we call this the standard inner product for Rn. Now, there are a lot of other inner products for Rn, but this is the simplest one. It's the most convenient one. This is used a lot more than any of the others. If you have a space of functions, you can get an inner product by multiplying the functions together and integrating them over whatever the domain happens to be. You hear I happen to go from 0 to 1. If we want polynomials, you'll want to go from 0 to 1. If you have other kinds of functions, maybe you want to go from minus infinity to infinity, or negative 32 to 7. These all will give you a kind of inner product, and we call this the L2 inner product. Finally, if you have a space of matrices, you might be interested in the inner product of two matrices being the trace of one of the transpose of one times the other. And that works out to just being the sum of aij times bij, where I and j run over all the entries of the matrix. So those are examples of inner products, fairly standard examples. Here are a couple of non-standard examples. On R2, we don't have to use the standard inner product. We could take x1, y1 plus twice x2, y2. You can go back and check that it satisfies the four axioms. That makes it an inner product. If you want to take a space of functions instead of multiplying f times g and integrating it, you could multiply f times g, multiply that by e to the minus t squared, and then integrate that. Okay. Now here's some things that aren't inner products. We could say, what about x1, y2 plus x2, y1? That's symmetric. If you swap the roles of x and y, it comes out to be the same thing. And it is linear in each term, but it's not positive. Because if you feed the vector 1 minus 1 and 1 minus 1, x1 times y1, x1 times y2 is negative 1, x2 times y1 is negative 1, adds up to negative 2, that's not positive. And then you have expressions that you sometimes see, like x1, y2 minus y2, x1, minus x2, y1. And that is linear, but it's not symmetric. If you swap the roles of x and y, you get minus what you started. Okay. Now, if you have any kind of vector space with an inner product, any of the examples that we had so far, then I claim that the inner product of two vectors, that's a number, and that number is somewhere between the product of the lengths of those two vectors and minus the product of the lengths. So the absolute value of the inner product is bounded by the length of x times the length of y, with equality if and only if x and y are linearly dependent. And what do I mean by the length of x? By the length of x, I mean the square root of x inner product with itself. Since the inner product of x with itself is positive, you can take its square root, and that gives you a number that we'll call the length. So here's our proof. By positivity, if you take any linear combination of x and y, so if you take x plus a constant times y, we'll call that constant t, and take its inner product with itself, you have to get something positive, or zero if this happens to be the zero vector. See, if they're linearly dependent, then I can find a linear combination that's zero, and so for some value of t, this will be zero. But if they're linearly independent, then this is a non-zero vector dotted into itself, will give you a positive number. And then you can expand it out using linearity. X times x, x times ty, ty times x, ty times ty. And then using symmetry, you say x times ty is the same thing as ty times x is t times x times y. And this is true no matter what value of t you pick. So if I pick a value of t that minimizes this expression, that minimum will still be positive. And the value of t that minimizes this expression happens to be minus inner product of x with y over y dot with y. You can do that by taking the derivative of this with respect to t and setting it equal to 0. You do a little bit of algebra, and you'll figure out that this is the t that minimizes the right-hand side. So if you plug this value of t back upstairs, you have to get something positive. So let's do that. So we get x dot x, and 2t times x times y. Well, t is minus x dot y over y dot y. So that times x dot y, you get x dot y squared over y dot y. I'm even calling it y dot y. I really should say the inner product of y with y. But since it behaves much like the dot product, I sometimes call it dot, just out of habit. And then t squared, you know, y inner product with y is x inner product with y squared over y inner product with y because of the value of t. And these are the same up to this factor of negative 2. So negative 2 times something plus that something is minus 1 times that something. And then we just keep on going. So we have 0 is less than, we take this expression and multiply it through by y inner product with y. That's a positive number by positivity. So 0 is less than or equal to x dot x y dot y minus x dot y squared. Put this on the left-hand side. X dot y squared is less than or equal to x dot x times y dot y. Now we take the square root of both sides. The square root of x dot y squared is the absolute value of x dot y. The square root of x dot x is the length of x. The square root of y dot y is the length of y. And we have that the size of the inner product is bounded by the size of x times the size of y. And we had equality if and only if x plus ty was 0. In other words, if they're linearly dependent, if x and y are pointing in exactly the same direction or are negatives of each other, then you can get equality. Otherwise, it's inequality. That means we can also start doing geometry. We can think about this kind, we can imagine, even if we're talking about functions, we can think about this kind of picture. We've got a vector in an abstract vector space, another vector in the abstract vector space, and we can imagine an angle between them. Because we define the angle between them to be the inverse cosine of the inner product over the product of the lengths. See, this is a number somewhere between negative and 1 and 1, so its inverse cosine is somewhere between 0 and pi. And we get back that the inner product is the length of one times the length of the other times the cosine of the angle between them, just like for dot products in R3, only now we're doing it in an abstract vector space. If I give you a space with an L2 inner product, I can ask, what's the angle between t and t cubed minus 1? And this gives us the power to do geometry. We can do law of cosines, we can do triangles, we can find equations of planes. All the geometric things that we're used to doing in R2 and R3, we can now do in any space that has an inner product.